Welcome to An Annotated Game by me, Jacob Wagner, a.k.a. Zen Chess. You can find me on chess.com, the Internet Chess Club, Play Chess, and Chess Cube, Zen Chess and all. Okay, so this game was played versus Mansoor Esra, who was rated about 2050, and it was a friendly sparring match at my house, and it wasn't a tournament or anything, but it was a 60-minute game with a 5-second increment, and I'm rated about 1970. And let's get straight into the game. Okay, I played e4. And he played c5. And so I played knight c3. Knight c6. And I played f4. So this is the start of the Grand Prix attack. And this is what I usually play. g6. So I played knight f3. I'm just developing pieces, and my bishop's usually going to come out to b5 or c4. Bishop g7, bishop b5, a6. So I guess this is like Ribka's move. Mansoor's been trying to challenge me in the Grand Prix attack, and I'm not sure if this is a good move, but it doesn't seem to be too bad. So I took the knight, and he played d takes c. So black has the bishop pair, and in compensation for white, white has pretty good development. If you count like tempos, you can see we have like 1, 2, 3, 4 for white, maybe 1, 2, 3 for black. No. So, I mean, white's development is good. And also, black has this pawn structure on the queen side, which isn't very mobile, because if it starts advancing, the weakness of the double pawns can show. So, for example, let's say I castle. Let's say black plays something like b5. Here the c5 pawn can become very weak, so if I play something like b3 to stop c4 or whatever, and you know, I can attack the c5 pawn with bishop to a3 eventually, or bishop to e3, and it just can't be defended by another pawn, so it's a weakness. And there's other ways that white could attack these pawns, but Mansoor has this idea where he's gonna basically just leave the pawns where they are, and he's gonna play b6 and a5. That way there's no obvious weakness of the pawns. So like he played knight f6. Let's say I play pawn to a4. He's not gonna let me play pawn to a5, because that would if I played pawn to a5, you know, now I can attack c5 and jump into b6. And if he ever plays something like b6, then I can just take the pawn, and then he's got these weak doubled isolated pawns, which can be attacked pretty easily. So that's why if I play a4, he's going to play a5. Oops, sorry about that. He's going to play a5. And then eventually he's going to play b6, and then he doesn't have any huge attackable weakness with the double pawns. That being said, with the pawns sitting like that, they're not going to be very mobile. So it's not a big deal, but it could become a factor. So what happened was, I castled and he played knight f6. And then I played d3. Okay, so I'm just making normal moves. I'm going to shift my queen over to e1, where I can come out to h4, or f2, or g3. And I'm just going to see what happens in the game before I commit to any specific plan. If you've ever seen the Grand Prix before, there's a typical attack where white plays his queen to e1 and to h4. And that goes something like this. These are just this isn't the game. So queen to e1, and I'm just gonna make some silly moves for black. I play a queen to h4. I'm gonna continue to make silly moves for black. Then I play pawn to f5, opening up this diagonal. And the main idea of the attack, which you can see from Roman since yesterday's videos, is bishop to h6, and then knight g5, and then you can just exchange on g7. Oops. If black exchanges, it's pretty hopeless, so just make more silly moves for black. You exchange on g7. You take on g6, you sack the exchange, and then you mate on h7. So that kind of idea is a very dangerous attack because of the weakness of black's dark squares and the ability of white to funnel its pieces over there. Also, this knight can come into the attack after pawn to e5. So that is basically what I might be going for. Back to the game. Black played queen to b6, so when black plays queen to b6, the course of the game has changed dramatically because he's threatening c4 check, and so I put king h1 to get out of any check, and that just makes my life easier. It wasn't necessary right away because if he did play c4 check, I could play pawn to d4 to kind of block the diagonal. But you're just asking for trouble if you're going to allow this pin in the check. So I think it's a much better style to play king h1, and then you play knight g4. So with knight g4, he's still threatening something like c4 and knight f2. The other thing that I was a little bit worried about was if he plays something like knight e3, and we'll see that what could have happened in the game. So if he plays knight e3, bishop takes c3 and queen takes b2. I had to look at this before I was able to play pawn to h3. I had just calculated something like knight to a4, attacking his queen, and I haven't analyzed this with Ripka or anything, or Houdini, but I believe White's doing well here. So, I mean, I spent quite a bit of time just thinking of that knight e3. So anyways, I played pawn to h3, and I'm just forcing black to show his hand. I mean, he's gonna have to either retreat the knight or do what he did, which is pawn to h5, and I actually didn't expect that move. The idea of pawn to h5 is, of course, it's a piece sacrifice, but it opens the h file. And so if I capture the knight, sorry about that, knight h2 and then g3, and then he's recapturing this piece on this file, and also the threat of this diagonal is very powerful, and it would basically lead to some kind of checkmate. In any case, black gets his piece back. So after h5, I played queen to e1. And this is where my queen wanted to go anyways. It protects the knight on c3. It stops any knight f2 check. It stops knight e3. And it also protects the g3 square so that if I get a chance to take the knight, like this, check, knight h2, and then g3, and I can just take on g3. So he won't get his piece back in that variation. So queen e1, I think, was a good move. And he had to retreat his knight, so he played knight h6. And I'm not really sure h6 was a better square than f6. On h6, the knight never really got back into the game. See, it can't go to f5 unless I play e5. So I'm just not going to play e5, and my pawn's well placed on e4 already. So So I believe that knight f6 would have been a better choice. And here I saw this move, queen f2. And this seems like a pretty good move, because it pins the c pawn to black's queen. So I'm threatening knight to a4, attacking the queen, and picking up the c5 pawn. So when I play queen f2, it's also developing move of the queen. And the only major downside is that it could be attacked by knight g4, which I still have to worry about. He played queen a7. So what he's trying to do is get out and play b6. That way he won't have to worry about his c pawn anymore. So I played bishop to e3, which is just a normal developing move, and it also attacks c5, so this developing move comes with tempo, even though black was playing b6 anyways. b6. And here, I made a mistake, although it's not an obvious mistake. I decided that since I was up in development, so I have 1, 2, 3, 4, castle, a couple center pawns, I have a pretty good development here. Black's knight on h5 is out of the game, and black hasn't castled, hasn't developed a c8 bishop. So I decided to open the game, and there was a pretty forced variation where I gained control of the d-file. Unfortunately, it doesn't quite work out immediately. So the reason it doesn't work out is when I played pawn to d4, black has this amazing move, knight to g4. So he's just coming back. And if I take the knight, he takes the nobleman's h-file with check. I play knight h2. And now he plays c takes d4. So he's forking my knight and bishop. And if I take on d4, then he plays g3. And that's the in-between move that I don't think either of us saw. And that move is just really good, because if white captures the pawn, for instance, then black can capture on d4, and he's got the two bishops, he's got the open h-file, just a little bit behind in development, but this position is absolutely good for black. So that's what could have happened, but it required some calculation, and neither of us saw during the game. Instead, black captured on d4. I captured on d4, attacking his g7 bishop and attacking b6, so he's pretty much forced to exchange. And I captured with the queen because I want to control the d-file. Black's rook is under attack, so he castled. And then I played rook and a to d1. So here black is kind of suffering. He can't challenge the d-file, unfortunately. So I can basically build up my position, maybe triple on the d-file, maybe do something with my knights like knight e5 or knight g5 or f5. It turns out through computer analysis was a crushing threat in some variations. And the point of f5 is just to open his king side. So he played queen c7. And he's just getting his queen a little bit closer and trying to defend. He's also attacking the f4 pawn. And I wanted to protect the f4 pawn, so I wanted to move my knight. And I thought about knight to e5. And I almost played knight to e5. I thought it was a good centralizing move. It attacks c6, protects. The thing I was worried about, the other thing, good thing about knight e5 is that if he plays f6 to kick my knight out, I can take on g6. But then I realized that the other move I was considering, knight g5, stops him from playing bishop to e6. So I played knight g5. And he played b5. There were some other options, like pawn to c5. The computer recommends knight d5, c takes d4, knight takes c7. And I'm gonna win a pawn. But it's difficult to play that in an over the board game. Just see that you're gonna win a pawn, and that might have been an okay defense for black to consider. He played b5, and of course this opens the c5 square. But black had a particular defensive scheme in mind, so I played queen c5. And he played rook a7. Now, the computer gives two question marks on this move and says that I should play f5 here, and it's a crushing attack. But it's difficult to really see what that does from my point of view anyway, so I didn't see that idea at all. And I played rook to d3. I was thinking of the various ways to get a rook lift. I almost played rook to d4, I almost played rook to f3, but I ended up playing rook to d3, and then I realized, I'm giving black some kind of play because he comes to e6 and then he has a bishop c4 threat, so he's going to gain a tempo off of my rook. Luckily for me, it turned out incredibly well. But he played f6, kicking my knight out. I played knight f3, and he played bishop e6. So I played rook on f to d1, doubling on the file. And he can't necessarily play bishop c4 now. Because I have things like rook d7, or even if I don't, sorry about that. Okay, rook d1, and he played rook b7. So with rook b7, he's just moving his rook out of attack because my queen was attacking it. And he's threatening to take on f4. So then I had this idea of knight to d4, which attacks his bishop. And after bishop c4, I would go to g3. So it turns out maybe my rook isn't misplaced on d3. So this is what happened in the game. Rook g3. So I'm threatening rook to g6, of course. And I thought during the game, if he takes an f4, which is what he did, I would play rook takes g6, king h7, and then just capture the pawn on h5, and I'd be just in a dominating position. But then instantly he played bishop to f7, pinning my rook. And I didn't see that move, and I thought right away, I thought, oh my god, I'm dead lost. Of course, I can sack the exchange and maybe pick up the c6 pawn, but it's not really what I wanted to do. I didn't want to give up the exchange, I wanted to just be in a clearly winning position. So I had to think for a while and find something brilliant to save my rook, and luckily, there was something there, but to say that I saw this beforehand is a complete lie. So, knight to e6. And I play this move simply to gain time and simply to get his bishop off of my rook so that I have more time to attack something. And basically, you'll see what happened in the game. So, knight e6, and he takes the knight. Now, if he doesn't take the knight and he takes my rook, then I capture on f8. And then I can capture on g6 with either queen or knight. And I'm doing excellent because I picked up a full rook there. So knight e6. And this is just like an amazing shot that came out of nowhere. Bishop takes e6. And so believe it or not, I still thought I was lost. And I just played knight e6 because I knew it was the right move. I mean, I can't explain really. I knew I needed to unpin my rook for there to be anything in the position, and maybe that was a pretty bad decision. Maybe I should have just sacked the exchange and taken the c6 pawn. But anyways, I finally realized that, of course, Black's queen was defending the knight. I didn't realize that until just about now in the game. And so all I have to really do is distract the queen from the defense of the knight, and it's going to be checkmate on h6. So I looked for moves like rook f1, g3, and then finally I saw knight e2, and he played queen e3, and then rook d3, and now he just has no squares to keep his queen on the diagonal. So if he were to play something, like queen f2. It's mate immediately with queen takes h6 checkmate. So what happened in the game is he decided to get as much material as possible. Unfortunately, his pieces are unconnected, his rooks aren't connected, his knight's on the rim. And his king still has some danger, so even though he is down 2 points, but even though he's close in material, it's just because his pieces are so uncoordinated, he doesn't have much of a chance here. So bishop f7, I played e5, bishop d5, and here there's other wins like rook g3, but I just wanted to play simply, and I wanted to cut off the bishop from the king side, and that was pretty effective. So he played rook d6, I played rook g3, he played bishop e4. Now he's threatening to just go to g6, and I can't. Maybe I still have rook takes g6, but it just makes it a little more difficult. So I played queen h5 to stop that. I played rook d2, and then I played rook g6. So it's pretty much over at this point. He resigned on this move, but it's a good resignation because I have queen takes h6, king g8, knight g8, and apparently it's a very quick mate. All you can do is give some spite checks, and then I made an h8. So this was my annotated game against Monster Ashraf, and thanks everybody for watching. And stay tuned to my YouTube channel and zenchess.com for more annotated games and chess instruction and just all sorts of chess stuff. Thank you very much. Goodbye.